pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dr. McLeod, do we have any recognitions tonight?
We do.
Do you want to skip that, or what do you want to do?
They're quick.
Okay, all right. On to recognitions. Oh, wait, I'm supposed to go through the agenda. Yeah, I'm sorry.
You know, I don't get enough practice, and then I get dusty. I'll go through the agenda. We have recognitions, and then we have our first public comment, the reports to the school committee, then which we'll have a student council member if they are here. We'll have Mr. Bishop and Mr. Hannah discuss the F1 visa update. We'll have liaison reports, the school committee chair report, the superintendent's report, which will include the end of cycle progress and our tech budget. And then on to new business, we'll be talking about the middle school club stipends, the school bus contract recommendation, expense transfers, capital project articles. It looks like we have no old business this evening. We'll have another opportunity for public comment, and then items by consensus. And Dr. McLeod, now we can move on to recognitions.
Well, my first recognition tonight is our own Officer Powers, who didn't want me to say anything, so I'm delighted to congratulate him for receiving the SRO Exceptional Service Award from Mass Juvenile Officers. And there's a picture of him from HCAM here with holding his award, and he's very humble about it all. But we really are very proud of him, and I know that the kids really connect with him, and he's exceptional in what he does in terms of, you know, the personal contact he has with kids. I've seen him in so many different situations, stressful and non-stressful, and they just know he's there for them, and he knows them well, and he knows them by name.
I know, that's amazing.
And he is such a wonderful resource to our community, beyond the high school. He's in all of our schools at a moment's notice. So congratulations, Phil, really well deserved. I would also like to recognize our high school concert band, who earned a gold medal at the MICA Festival last weekend. As a result of their gold medal, they have been selected to perform at Symphony Hall on Saturday, April 16th, between 2:30 and 3:30. What is, I spoke with Craig, and we will be inviting Craig to come to a school committee meeting to recognize him probably in May, when he'll also do his end of year report, as we've done in the past, because it was too soon to turn it around. But he said it's kind of interesting, because I think that there are 10 of his 10 students going to China that are in the symphony. Right. So of this group that has been selected to perform, he's having to kind of add some additional members, because a good portion of this group will not be here, because they're going to be going on a very exciting trip to China. So, and then my third recognition is for Mr. John Parker, a middle school phys ed teacher. He has been selected by the Massachusetts Association of Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance as the 2016 Middle School Teacher of the Year recipient. It is a noteworthy honor given to a MAHPERD member who has made significant contributions in the fields of physical education and health. The award will be awarded to Mr. Parker this Sunday at an awards banquet that many of us will be attending on his behalf, to be there to support him. So that's this Sunday at the DoubleTree Hotel in Milford. Mr. Keller and I are going, along with other members of the middle school staff. So congratulations, Mr. Parker. We have all sorts of awards going to our middle school phys ed department. Deb Pinto this week is at her. I know she came and spoke to you about her exciting opportunity. She's there this week, so we'll find out the results. She doesn't find out until Saturday whether or not she earns that distinguished award, but I'm sure she's having a wonderful experience. And she thanks all of us for our support to make that happen. That's it for my recognitions. I don't know if anybody else has any. Okay.
Okay, we will move on to our first opportunity for public comment. Is there anyone in the public who'd like to comment? They're signaling no at this point. So we can move on to reports to the school committee. It appears we don't have a student council representative here with us. If they do join us, we'll bring them in. But at this point, we'd like to call up Mr. Bishop and Mr. Hannah.
Right here.
I know Mike's over there.
Yes. Right.
I did shower.
So thank you both for being here. I always want to just be very appreciative when administrators come. We're always delighted to see them at our meetings, but also I always like to note that the time of the day that they are here and the time that their day starts. But thank you for being here, and thank you for the topic that we're going to talk about, because I think I'm always really impressed with the improvements that administration is looking to make to current programs, and doing it in a way that isn't going to add additional cost to our budget, but all the while improving what the offerings are for students. So they're here to talk firsthand about a proposal or some. It's really an update on what they are looking to do with the F1 visa program. So I'll turn it over to you, Evan.
Good evening, everyone, and thanks for having us. Mr. Hanner and I are here to give you guys an update on the F1 program and talk about some exciting changes and enhancements we'd like to make for next fall. Mr. Hanner is obviously one of the assistant principals, and he's the administrator that oversees the F1 program and does most of the work with it. So I think it's important that he's here to talk about some of the things we'd like to do next fall. Since we started the F1 program, as Gene probably remembers back 6 or 7 years ago, we've accepted 15 students per year from a variety of different countries. And the tuition that we receive gets put into an F1 account, and we use that, as you know, for a variety of different reasons. And so we're here tonight to bring to your attention, we've had quite a few conversations at the high school level, some thoughtful discussion, and we feel it's time that we increase our enrollment from 15 students to 17 students. We feel it's important, as we're consistently looking for ways to improve the program, to make it better, to create more opportunities for both our F1 students, but also our Hopkinton students and our families that take part in it. Over the last 3 years in particular, we have seen an increase in the quality of candidates that are applying. I think that goes to the reputation that we have. We've had to turn away some really talented kids that we feel would have just been great additions to the high school. And I think by adding a few more students, it'll make the program better, but it'll also continue to help diversify our population, which I think is very important. So we have at this time accepted 15 students for next fall. We do have two very exceptional students on hold right now. We wanted to have this conversation with you before we moved forward with it. With the money that we would receive tuition-wise, we do have some thoughts on how we'd like to spend it. It's a little bit of a combination between a student ambassador program that Mr. Hannah is going to talk about in a second, and also for additional funding for our Mandarin Chinese program. So I thought we would start with the student ambassador program in terms of the money that will be coming in.
So the student ambassador program was an idea that Andy Longoria and I, who is one of the assistants to the F1 program as it stands today, came up with in an effort to improve and enhance the F1 student experience at the high school, and also create a stronger cultural exchange for students at Hopkinton High School as they currently stand. And the idea behind it is to match current Hopkinton High students, two or three, with each of the individual F1 students. So at the beginning of the year, when we have our welcoming day, the day or two before school starts, we would pair them up based on interests and age and such, and they would follow those students throughout the calendar year, be kind of like representatives to the high school, and also give our F1 students an improved experience at the high school. Because what we've seen in the last 3 years is that they're taking great advantage of our educational system, but culturally and socially, we see room for growth. And not all of the host families that they stay with have high school students at their homes, and so building a relationship there would help strengthen that. Similarly, our students would then create great contacts that would theoretically be lifelong, and encourage them to take part of some of the exchanges that the companies we work with offer. But I think at this point our students are a little hesitant to take that step, because maybe they'd like to learn a little bit more firsthand about what that might feel like. So there's two areas that we're trying to hit upon regarding this ambassadorship program. But we know we have students who love international travel based on the trips we supply each year. Kids want to go out. We just feel like this would be a great opportunity for us to build those. And in terms of where some of the money might go, we'd like to take advantage of some of the great attractions in the New England area and pair up some of our international students with our Hopkinton students and subsidize some of those explorations. So we could have an F1 trip to Faneuil Hall as an obvious example, and that perhaps some of the money would help, you know, pay for a bus or things like that, where right now those students are doing that on their own, and we'd like to see the school kind of help support some of that to strengthen what right now is a strong program, but certainly we'd like to go from good to great.
And so following up on that, so the other part that we would like to put some money towards is this is our fifth year of our Mandarin Chinese program, and the numbers continue to get bigger and bigger. We just ran our course selection process for the current juniors, sophomores, freshmen, and eighth graders, and the numbers for Chinese warrant six classes, but we only have one teacher to teach five classes. So we would like to get another 0.2 FTE to add to the Chinese program. So that's where some of the money would be going. I think there would still be some additional money from the tuition that we would get that we could use in other ways, but these would be the two things that we would like to spend the money on if we were able to get the two additional students.
So what I didn't realize is that there was a waiting list. I was thinking that we were going to have to wait to know whether or not we could secure the number of students in order to be able to fund, but I was going to suggest that I come back. Basically, we would be looking at a transfer request for you to approve with the additional funds that would come into the F1 visa program, as opposed to approving the additional number of students. I did ask that question of Josh and of Ashok in terms of do we have a set number of students that we had previously had the school committee agree that this was a cap, and that isn't the case. So my thinking on this is that we would make you aware of what we'd like to be able to do once we are able to confirm that we actually have the additional income. Then we would come back and request your approval on using F1 visa funds to fund an additional teacher. Is everyone comfortable with that?
Yep.
And we would know, when would we know?
Well,
by the summer?
Yeah, we can know very soon. It's a very attractive school for students around the world to come to, so we're constantly being submitted applications, and our goal is to try to create as diverse a class as possible, so all places around the world are represented in each cohort to allow for the students in Hopkinton to meet friends from everywhere. You know, the last point I think important to state is the critical nature of this program. As our world continues to become smaller and smaller, these relationships are that much more important. No longer are people able to just stay within their bubble. We need to build friendships. We need to have understanding, and no better place than a public high school to showcase that. So I think that more than anything, is where the heart of this program began and what we're trying to continue to grow.
Sure.
So first off, thank you very much for the update, especially as Dr. McLeod noted on this topic, which increasingly on an annual basis is a budget exercise for us, which is probably incredibly unfair to the program. You know, the desire to increase diversity in our schools is, and it's great to hear that it's such a success. Not necessarily questioning it, but just curious, where did we get to two? Like, why?
I have that question.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Why not 20?
I think we settled on two because, and you can jump in too. I mean, it was a number we felt, we first decided one, and then we're like, we can go to two. I think the host families is a question. That sometimes is the most difficult piece. So I think we could probably increase it 10 to 15 people, but I just don't think we'll have the host families for that. And we feel, talking with Andy Longoria, talking with Josh, that two would be a reasonable number to increase, thinking we'd have the number of host families that we would need.
Yeah. Great.
But I know it does seem like kind of a random number.
Well, you said we're going to go from 15 to
17,
30.
And I think if it works, we can continue to grow it, but we wanted to take baby steps, so to speak.
Well, that was going to be my question, because I do see requests a lot that go out looking for host families, even like halfway through the year when some of them switch and whatnot. So that was going to be my question. And just I do have a couple more just for context. We were way at the front of this program, and I'm curious if there are other schools right in this area that are starting to develop this program, and if so, if that might also be a nice, you know, larger social opportunity that we could take advantage of and co-sponsor field trips. I think that's a wonderful idea to take the kids out and explore, and they might really love to have other kids in the surrounding towns.
There's quite a few towns around the area that we go to our tech meetings with local communities, and they all pretty much have a similar program. So,
yeah, and I think the student ambassador thing is a great idea. I really applaud how much thought you continue to put into this, because as you said, it is a very successful program, but I like to see that you're continually thinking about how to make it richer for not only our Hopkinton students, but for the students who are joining us from abroad. And I guess my only final question, as you said, a lot of the or some number of the host families don't have kids in the high school, and I don't know what you're already doing sort of as a support or networking for those families, and maybe that might help expand the number of families interested in hosting kids, if that social culture could be built up a little bit. But what I like particularly about matching them with students is probably for F1 students staying with families who have not had kids go through the high school, by the time they sort of get immersed into the culture and start to see how things work, they may feel like, oh, it's too late for me to try out for the play or be the manager of this team or whatever. And so connecting them with students earlier who really know what, you know, might be a fun club or this is a great teacher or whatever, I think that's a really great enhancement, especially if the parent or their host families don't necessarily bring that to the table because of lack of experience. So anyway, that is a very long circular way of saying I think this is terrific.
Kelly, did you have anything?
Oh, mine was mostly around the 15 to 17. And then do you ever have students back out of the program? Is that if this is being used to fund a teaching position, do you worry about that?
Well, because of the high level of interest, we've been able to backfill anyone that has had, for whatever the reason, which in the 3 years I've been working the program, I've only had one student who got legitimately homesick after the beginning of first semester and decided to cut their year-long stay to a semester. We were able to find a second semester student. So that has not presented as a problem that I would say gives us any fear in regards to funding a teacher position. I forget what the second part of your question was. But
no, that was it. It was just because it would be helping to fund a position for Mandarin if you don't have that student.
More and more, this is becoming more popular across the world, and so more and more companies are now trying to feed us applications, and it's we're in the driver's seat from a standpoint of who can we select and how can we diversify this group for everyone's best interests.
And then just randomly, do you happen to know what kind of countries these 15 or 17 kids are from?
Well, the ones we just accepted?
The ones we just accepted, I don't have that off the top of my head.
We can
I know.
Get that for you. Okay.
I just wondered.
Today
no,
we have students from South Korea, China, Germany, Italy, Spain, France.
So it's really from all over the place. Not just, I thought it was going to be a couple countries.
From Scandinavia, I thought.
Yes, Denmark.
Yes, Denmark.
Denmark. Wow. And so we're looking to grow and expand to all the different continents, but for sure we have a pretty diverse cohort today.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
So my only question was, I had the same question John did about the 15 to 17, and you explained it fine, but I guess I'm also wondering, I didn't think about the host family aspect of it, but do we have any capacity issues within the high school that would prevent us from doing too large of a class as well?
I don't think yet.
Not yet, no.
And okay.
Adding two more kids isn't going to...
I don't mean the two, but like as the program grows,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think we have to continue to address that, and I think we've talked about it before as a group that we're, I know that the current seventh grade group is a very large group, and when that gets to the high school, we'll have the biggest school that we've ever had. So we have to be cautious of it, but that's why you don't want to add too many kids to the program. I think we have to be reasonable in how many we do add. So at most would be 20, but...
Are we assured that this is not in the middle of our film?
Like a
film?
Test pattern going off? Or?
I think we're sure that it is.
We're okay? That would be good. Well, this is a good demonstration of
right
you know, yes, being really
responsive
to
give live commentary?
An issue to prevent further damage.
It didn't even occur to me that it could be a pipe. I just thought it was there.
I don't think anyone had any other questions.
I do actually have one, but actually I think it might be unfortunately more of a Ralph question.
Oh, okay.
So
to
the point of, and I can probably find this, but it wasn't on the tip. So to that question about the back out, I don't think we zeroed out that revolving account in the budget.
No.
So we do have, so to the question earlier of like using this to fund something,
yeah.
That's a funding source discussion. And I think we still have enough money in that, even if for some reason we didn't get to 17 students.
Okay.
Right.
But we didn't want to go ahead and post an additional point two until we knew that we did have the funding source.
Right. I'm saying if it's a sort of a back catch if something happens.
Yes.
But yeah, I would agree with that.
So our timing would be probably to bring this back in June to request that in order to let you move forward with the additional hiring, et cetera.
Yeah, I mean the sooner the better.
Okay.
I know you guys are.
Well, as soon as you know you have the students, we can bring this back. Okay.
Great.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Okay. Have a great night.
You too. All right.
Thank you.
I'm a little disappointed. Right. The administrators I saw earlier tonight were in PJs. So these
seriously? Oh, that's right.
That's a story.
Thank you for
I don't think you'll ever see that.
So we now move on to liaison reports. Does anyone have any?
I have a quick one from ESBC. So we had an ESBC meeting on Tuesday, and the current phase that we're in is design development. So design development is where everything comes together. They have the construction, and help me with my terminology. They've got the construction manager on board, which is a company out of Holliston, I believe.
Yes.
And they've got the architects, and they've got the project management. And so they're all working together to work with the plans and the pricing and everything. So there's going to be, there was one meeting this week to discuss where we are with that. It sounds like there's going to be another meeting next week, maybe a smaller working group around the educational plan and things that are in the
yes.
current budget that have to do with the educational plan. And there is a, it sounds like an ESBC update, which is held every time there's an ESBC meeting. Mm-hmm. So Joe Markey and Mike
Shepherd
will be running that one, and that'll be
and Mr. Bonfatti
recorded.
Will be at that one as
oh,
well.
Oh, Mr. Bonfatti, mm-hmm. our project management. Mm-hmm. So that'll be recorded on HCAM, and it sounds like that'll be recorded on Friday.
Tomorrow
so
at 2:30.
An update. And mm-hmm. then we're also going to be looking to schedule sometime in the not so distant future another public forum to just get the public up to date on mm-hmm. on everything that's going on in this current phase. That's it.
Great. Anyone else? And I don't have any updates on...
Right, they didn't meet this month, did they?
I think we're not meeting this month because
Correct.
Of school vacation.
That's right, May is the next one.
Right. So, okay. Well, I guess we can move on to the chair report. And I do have a couple items to mention. First, I don't know if all of you have, but in preparation for budget season... Well, we already did our budget season, but right. in preparation for town meeting budget season, if anyone has not done their disclosure and had it filed with the town for this year, because we have to do it annually, please take it and submit it to the clerk's office.
Oh, mine's already in.
And we can have that all set to go because of any conflicts we might have due to fees and whatnot in our budget.
You said town clerk?
Yes. And the other part of our report is in regards to Dr. McLeod and Ms. Scordino meeting with the Appropriations Committee on Monday night during the snowstorm.
Nice.
There were discussions about... There were a few main topics. The main topics appeared to be our capital projects and how we prioritize those mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and whether we prioritize them. Mm-hmm. One particular lengthy topic of conversation was the scoreboard in the high school gym.
Mm-hmm.
But the other area of focus was on the increase in bus service expenses due to the fact that we have done away with the fees for K through 6. And the Appropriations Committee was asking that we move the amount of money in the budget from services for those increased services of the bus that were the bus fees would have countered that amount. I'm sorry, I'm not describing this very great. And you can always step in if I'm not
so
speaking.
So the reduction of fees for K-6 riders that would have added to reduce the transportation account.
Right. It's now increasing that account.
By around $55,000.
Right. And so they wanted us to move that line item to strategic initiatives of the school committee versus being a service fee or a service expense. And Ellen had sent each of us what she felt her the response should be of the school committee to that, and I can read a portion of it so that we all can discuss how we feel about that response to the Appropriations Committee. But in general, Ellen's feeling was, in talking with Ralph and talking with Dr. McLeod about what what that expense really is that it really is a service expense. It's the expense of and the cost of the buses. And if we had never had those fees instituted, those would be services that we would have to be paying for anyway. And they're not part of our strategic plan, and it's never been discussed as a strategic initiative of the school committee.
Well, we don't have called out in our strategic plan anywhere reducing fees as a strategic initiative, and that was the piece. Although it's something that previous school committees, and Jean, you've helped us with the history on that piece, and we have looked to reduce fees every year. This year, we chose as a committee to reduce those fees only around a particular area. But it's never been called out as a strategic initiative. And that was just the back and forth that we were trying to explain to appropriations, is that, you know, if there's an amount of money that they're tasked with bringing the budget, the overall budget back down to 2.5% increase, and if there's a percentage of that we as a school committee, you as a school committee have to come up with, we'll have to make that decision. But it seemed to be the only thing that they wanted to be identified as separate was this particular decision, which Ellen was just responding to say that after thinking about it, after she left the meeting, did not believe that in any way it was a strategic initiative. Other than that, I might add that they were very pleased with what we had to provide in terms of information, and Mr. Manning actually indicated as I left that we gave him more than they even expected. So they were very pleased with the amount of information that the school department had shared around strategic initiatives, particularly around personnel increases and decreases, how they were tied to initiatives, and how some of the additions have been, you know, countered by reductions. And we really did a good job, I believe, at explaining that piece. So this one little, I think there's just not agreement. And Ellen was looking to having some discussion here so that the rest of you, before she replies to appropriations on all of your behalf, to make sure that there isn't a difference of opinion.
And I think it's also important to point out again publicly that appropriations was invited to all of our budget meetings, and they did actually come to a couple of them. Mm-hmm. So I think obviously that likely assisted the process a bit that you had on Monday, because of the fact that they did get to hear the deliberations that we all had during those meetings with the administrators on their budget line items. Mm-hmm. And looking at the entirety of our budget versus this one issue that we're not in agreement with, I mean obviously it speaks volumes to how well your staff presented the budget and presented them with the information. So I'll read out just what Ellen had planned to send, and then we can discuss whether or not we're
not distracted.
It's blue.
It's still going in the bucket, though.
So, sorry.
I'm distracted by the television viewing audience.
Well, they're watching the same thing we are, so.
All right.
Can I just interject for 1 second? Before you read the response, can we decide if we feel that a response is required? Because it's not my understanding that they've made a request to us, but this was a conversation or a question. I mean, so I want to make sure I understand, because sure. I wasn't there. Yeah. Have they requested that we
yes,
reduce our budget?
Yes, they did. As we left, when I said, is there anything else that you need from us? And Mr. Manning said, actually, this is great. This is everything that, you know, more than we expected. A request was made of Ralph. Ellen had to leave. The request was directed to Ralph to make the change that they had requested, which was to move the amount that is pertaining to the K-6 reduction in fees out of transportation and into a strategic initiative, aligning it with a strategic initiative.
Okay.
And we just didn't know, and he agreed to that as we left the meeting. And then as a follow-up, after we started processing it and thinking, but it's not a strategic initiative, everything else that I was able to call out and align with our actual document and the numbers that it aligns to, as I've shared with you in the past, there wasn't anything specifically about okay. that. And so they did ask that we move it okay. out of transportation. And we didn't want to not reply and also not do what had been directly requested of Ralph.
Okay, then can I say one more thing before you read it? Just in terms of context, in our former strategic plan, this was a strategic initiative, mm-hmm. and it may be that they are operating from that basis you know, from that assumption and not realizing
it
that it isn't specifically delineated in this current strategic plan. So that just may be
some
piece of the confusion.
Yep.
So anyway.
I'm slightly unclear as to why it matters.
I can explain that if you'd like.
Because they did not ask us to reduce our budget.
No, so what I understand from conversations about with Ellen after the meeting, because I was actually supposed to attend and then Ellen was able to attend and then it was kind of this mixture. So I had checked in with her on Tuesday because I didn't go to the meeting. And what I understand is that there's a directive to the Appropriations Committee from the Board of Selectmen that there should be level service funding. So their perception of putting this in to our service fee, like into the services, it increased our services expense, and that perception is that we're not level funding our service, we're increasing it. So as part of their directive, they saw that as an opportunity for us to make a reduction in our service expenses. And that's where that.
Yeah, I think
so it's
that's
sort
right.
of just it's reporting. It's not asking us to take the $55,000 out of our budget. I mean,
that's correct.
Again, I mean, you could argue the semantics of the accounting all day. I mean, it's the expense is level service. It's a revenue offset we've used in the past that we've chosen not to use this time. We could use that revenue. We could have kept the revenue offset in our budget and used it for something else.
Well, exactly, and in fact, what we have done for the last several years is reduce fees in multiple categories, primarily in transportation, and so in a remarkably similar amount, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe that was 53,000 and this is 55, or that was 50 and this is 53. The difference is really negligible over a $40 million budget. So, you know, in my mind, in the category of fee reduction, we've stayed essentially flat. Where we have taken that reduction is what has changed. Mm-hmm. That is not a strategic initiative as identified in our current strategic plan, nor is it something that during our budget process we called out and named as a strategic initiative for this year. So as an example, full day K in the way that we did it wasn't necessarily in our strategic plan at the time, but we all made that a strategic initiative of that year. So we didn't for this amount of money do anything that rose to that level because it was essentially almost like a budget transfer. Maybe that's mm-hmm. too simplistic mm-hmm. a way to look at it, but I think that I've interrupted you so many times, you can go ahead and read the email, but I think that that would be my preference for sort of the explanation. That's the explanation that I sort of feel fits.
I think your response or your reminder, Jean, that in the past this has been a strategic initiative is a really important one, because I do believe that that's where the confusion might have come from. Because if you'd been part of the conversation, it was like we were talking two different languages. Mm-hmm. And there was repetition over this. And so maybe there was confusion around the fact that, but we thought that was your strategic initiative. I certainly didn't expect the Appropriations Committee to come having been completely well-versed in our strategic plan.
Right, right.
You know, in terms of looking at it, really, I would expect them to ask me to lead them through that, so which is what I tried to do. So it could have come down to simply a misunderstanding based on this being a strategic initiative in the past, and then the way in which you describe it, John, as far as it's just not a revenue source.
And I think that the other piece I think that gets me about this is the term strategic initiative. So in the past, we've had a strategic initiative around the reduction of fees. And fair enough that the this maybe got lost in translation a little bit, but this to me, a strategic initiative is a reasonably long to midterm goal that we set out that we're trying to achieve to advance the district, the curriculum in some form. The discussions, and to your point, Lori, the Appropriation Committee was invited to our discussions. They did participate in a couple of them. This was a decision that wasn't about a strategic initiative. This was a decision that we based on, first of all, I mean, the numbers played into it in terms of the size of it, but this was a decision that Dr. McLeod had recommended based on student safety, because students living within 2 miles of a school don't have the opportunity to walk to school in a safe environment. It was a decision that was made based on the fact that the fee is in and of itself discriminatory in favor of, or discriminatory to people that happen to live within 2 miles of a school building sort of arbitrarily, and to a point that was made in a conversation to me earlier this week on this topic. We've actually chosen to build a school in a place that might be within 2 miles of a place where people lived and wouldn't have had to pay a fee before.
Right.
So in that way, they didn't even move within 2 miles of the school. We're dropping a school within 2 miles of their house.
So now they have to pay.
In particular, I feel it's important to bring, maybe I personally feel it's important to bring this up, because while I didn't attend the meeting, I do know that motivation for this particular initiative was personally ascribed to me inaccurately. And that our focus was on the safety of the students, and quite frankly, the fairness of this fee to the residents of the town. As we say with all these fees, you can call it an expense increase. If we put the fee back in, taxpayers are still paying for it. We've just focused it on particular taxpayers. Yeah. And it's not, to the idea that there's any personal motivation, which I know was brought up in this meeting, by members of the committee is, first of all, factually untrue, because I don't think there's anyone on here, myself included, who pays a bus fee. But the, oh, sorry, in the K to six, I'm sorry. but that this, again, was not a strategy. This was not a personal decision. This was something that was a decision of the full committee to focus on student safety and to focus on fairness to the citizens of the town. Yeah. If we want to call that a strategic initiative, then everything in the budget's a strategic initiative. Well, so I don't.
The other thing that I think is important to remember is that we are the only committee, I believe, period, that has a strategic plan, right? Mm-hmm. So the budget message is created and crafted to apply to all of the departments, and so they have to call it something. So we have a more clearly, I may be misspeaking, because I honestly don't remember if the Board of Selectmen has one or not, so I don't want to assume that they don't. But by and large, the school committee is the committee that is driven, our budget process is driven by a specific strategic plan. And so when they're crafting their budget message, I understand why part of that for all departments is, please tell us your strategic initiatives. They may not be mapped out for the next 5 years the way that ours are. And I think that, you know, in fairness to the Appropriations Committee, they're charged with sort of enforcing that. And particularly this year, I think they were specifically tasked with, you know, finding ways to get the budget back down to a level that the Board of Selectmen were more comfortable with. And so, you know, they're trying to hold everybody accountable to the budget message that was delivered in the fall. So I think it's important, as my father would say, to keep the emphasis on the right syllable. And the point is, A, they're not asking us to reduce our budget. B, if that request does come to us in the process that the entire town will go through, because reductions need to be made across the board, because it's a school committee budget, and according to Mass General laws, even if we call that a strategic initiative or a birthday party, they can't say this is the part you need to change. That's our decision, and we make that in the context of the full budget and our strategic plan. So I guess I just say all of that as, you know, I would prefer that the email response be clarifying in that, yes, we have formally had a strategic plan initiative to reduce fees. That's not part of our current strategic plan. However, the fee reduction that we've made is comparable to what we've done for the last 5 years. It's focused in one direction. It's one in one area particularly. We did that this year because we've grown increasingly uncomfortable with this, and this, plus we have the elementary school building and blah, blah, blah. And so that would be my preferred response. However you want to craft that, that's what I'm putting out there on the table, and certainly interested in what the rest of you have to say. But I think getting hung up on semantics is not really benefiting anybody at this point.
you know.
Yeah, I mean, I do sort of come back to Jean's point about the structure of the budget process, about sort of why it matters that we call it a strategic initiative or not. However, I do think it's important to note in the response that this was a decision that was made on the factors that we talked about, and that this is not, because again, to me, this is different than the 10% annual reduction in fees. There was a large part of this that was about the idea that children within 2 miles of the school can't reasonably be expected to walk to school.
Yes, I remember Mr. Mosier was actually at that meeting commenting himself how uncomfortable he would be if his students were walking any of the streets to the school. So the Board of Selectmen were actually here for that meeting that we had that discussion.
Well, while I agree with that, I will say that our older students are walking on those streets, right? So, and they are older, and that's fine, but you know, I have had feedback from people who are saying, well, you're just, now the taxpayers are just paying more for those students to get to school. And my response to that is, actually, according to the plan that we've been following for the last 4-ish, 5 years, I don't know, the change to your taxes is the same amount, because it's about the same amount of money. What, you know, people in my age group don't like is that they have been paying bus fees K-12, and they are not getting the good news break that the elementary are. However, it applies to all 7-12 graders. So that's a conversation for a different day. But I just say that by way of highlighting, you know, everybody comes from their own perspective in this community based on, you know, whether, how old their kids are, do they have kids, and where they are in the school district. But so I think that you're right to highlight that this one was a fee that did not apply equally to all students across those grade levels, and that, you know, safety concerns were increasing, and that in addition that, you know, we'd be moving the elementary school, and this was just a good time to address this issue specifically. So
okay, I don't think there's a need to read Ellen's email out loud based on the fact that I think, unless we have further comment, and we all agree on what points need to be hit to respond back to the Appropriations Committee, and then we can revise the response a bit with adding some more information. And either, if people want, we can send it around again where you can respond directly to Ellen, rather than, obviously, we're not going to deliberate over email. Does that sound like, I took notes as well, okay. So we can
put our heads together.
Yeah.
But do you feel like that, I mean, because I wasn't there, based on the meeting that you did have, do you feel like that addresses what the concerns are?
I do, Jean. I feel like it's important to make a response, because I don't want to be in the next public meeting with appropriation and have them feel like they asked us to do something and we neither did it nor responded why. So I've noted, you know, truly it is level funded. If you compare with the fee reductions that we've done in previous years, it's the same amount that we've reduced, we've just done it differently. And I've noted that although it was a strategic initiative in previous years, so I've got that piece of it. Lori's also made some notes based on your feedback, and I think together we can put together a respectful response to appropriations that clearly communicates not our position, but because it does become semantics, but just our intent to not actually take $55,000 out of what's now the transportation expense. Okay. Yes?
Yep. Anything else?
Everyone summarized. I just say be succinct and not.
Yes.
So don't apologetic. Let me write it.
Right.
Okay. That's all for the school committee chair report, and we can now move on to Dr. McLeod's report.
Well, I think you'll be very pleased to hear that I'm not going to, this is, tonight's meeting is not going to be the one where we're going to need more time, so this should be able to be fairly succinct. I wanted to, however, review the timeline publicly and draw your attention to a few things. The first is the draft plan, sorry, the end of cycle report, which I've shared with you, and I believe only you at this point. When this whole process is complete, of course, this becomes a public document and everybody will have access to it. But so the timeline is, tonight I provide my end of cycle report. At our next meeting on the 28th, that's where we'll have a discussion on, you're going to give me some public feedback. But before you do, you will all submit a copy of the end of cycle summative that I've given each of you. I've given you each a blank document as well as a copy of my self-evaluation. You'll submit your end of cycle summative report to Ellen, who will compile and summarize all of the information. And sometime over the April vacation, she and I will get together. So we'll give you some feedback in terms of timeline. The idea between the 28th and the final summative is for us to have some additional, you know, checks and balances based on, and it's something that we built in after our first year, for those of you who are on the committee, where we didn't have a chance to have that conversation, and there was some. So the idea is that by the time we come back on the 28th, I will have had feedback from all of you, and I will have Ellen will provide me with your actual evaluation, so I will get to hear from each of you. She'll summarize it, and then there'll be a final meeting at which point, at where you provide the summative. But the opportunity for conversation is really on the 28th, where you've had a chance to really look at my evidence and what I've given in terms of a self-evaluation. What I'm looking for from you between now and then is if, and tonight we can, if you've had a chance and you have feedback from me now, what I need to know is if there is evidence lacking. So in order for you to evaluate me on any level, whether it be, you know, needs improvement or proficient, if you're feeling like you really can't make that recommend or that evaluation because there just isn't, there's lacking in evidence, that feedback would be really appreciated. So I've really tried to improve. Sorry, I'm going to back up one step before I do. Lori and I were discussing the timeline and how it feels really rushed and how it feels mm-hmm. that, you know, we just did the mid-cycle in January. Next year will feel much better because next year I begin a two-year cycle. So as a fourth-year superintendent, I now am on a two-year cycle. And it's the same with our teachers. It's the same with our administrators. They're on one-year plans for the mm-hmm. first 3 years. So next year at this time, we'll be doing a mid-cycle. And then the end of cycle won't be until the following spring. So it will feel much less rushed. But the reason for the way that we have it laid out is so that I'm not being evaluated by a brand new school committee member who's sitting here and has had no part of this process. Or it could be two new school committee members in a given year. So that's why the timeline has been the way it is. With that said, I've organized folders that you've had access to for each of my four goals. And within the folders, I've tried to highlight folders within folders, particularly under assessment. I want to point out to you that under the assessment goal, I'm creating folders. Student success plans. So under student success plans within assessment, there will be folders, which I'm in the process of preparing for you, that you'll have by the weekend for each school and then for the special education director. And I've been working with each of those individuals to provide me with data around several initiatives, adjustment to practice, evidence of student success, feedback to educators in their evaluations. And so the issue is that I need to go in and redact any student name or teacher name in those folders and then upload and get them to you. So I'm working on that. It is time-consuming, and so it's not complete, but I believe that you will feel that you have much more information around that area. I know that you requested it of me at the mid-cycle, and I've been working to try to get you what you need. But if you could take a look at it over the weekend so that if there is more evidence that you're needing from me, I have a chance to get it to you before you're evaluating me, that would be greatly appreciated. Under each of the annual plan itself, you can see that I've provided the key actions that I've taken and some follow-up as to whether or not those goals have been met or whether they're in progress. Under each of these, I believe there's evidence in the evidence folder. So although it seems rather, it won't look very detailed on the actual written document, it's because the evidence, I think, speaks for itself. So the three areas were professional practice goal was communication, Student learning goal was under assessment. The district improvement goal was under operational systems, and community and business engagement were the two district improvement goals. So I'll pause for feedback, questions, or comments.
It's on my calendar to do that this week.
Thank you.
I don't have any feedback yet.
Okay.
Yeah, I would say at this point, thank you for outlining the timeline.
Yep.
Agreed. I look forward to the two-year cycle, not just so we don't have to do this every year, but because that timeline does feel a little bit fractured.
Yes.
So, and then as I go through the evidence folder, if it's missing anything, I'll reach out.
Thank you. That'll be great. You had something. The assessment, I think I've answered that one.
Yeah, so I just asked. I knew that you would have student data to show how there's been improvement in the student population, but just didn't see it in there yet, and that's what you were just discussing about the fact that you'd have to redact it. The only other piece that I, it was confusing to me, and that was in the operations folder, was there's multiple spreadsheets with projects that are ongoing, and each spreadsheet seems to be centered on a specific update time, date. And so I just didn't know if there was a way to show, and it may just be strictly that I need to lay them down next to each other and see, but it was hard to tell if these were separate projects or if they're ongoing projects, or because there was three different spreadsheets with different times. Yeah. So it may just be I need to understand.
So no, it's not at all. It's that I haven't explained it well. So first of all, in the folders, and this is based on some of your feedback in the past where you've said, well, you've shown me the evidence, but I don't really know what it means. I've given you for each folder an outline. This is what you will find in this folder, particularly around assessment. And I've given you to show you this is what this one means. And so it'll be much more of a roadmap for you. What I haven't done, and I will do under the operations piece, is those project updates were to show you the process that's been established. So those things were that was never in place before. And I wanted you to see under, if I go
to the request process from
the operational systems, the develop a reporting structure for principals to review progress. So I can tell you, although it's not easily determined by looking at what I gave you, that everything on that update was completed. And so working with the Director of Operations to Buildings and Grounds, I should say, to have timelines in place so that if I'm a building principal and I don't see any progress on the project and it's the beginning of August, I can look and see where you are on the project, that you've got piece parts ordered, or where I am on the timeline. That was the intent. It was to improve communication, but also to improve planning around having it done. Everything was completed, but we also have a plan in place to begin right after town meeting this year and not waiting. So that isn't clear to you just by looking at the folder, so I'll articulate, give you some background.
Okay, thank you.
And so that's great feedback. That's an example of what I need.
Otherwise, I have to say it was, I don't know if it's because it's the second year doing it, but the evidence folders were much clearer to me this time around, even from January. So I think you've done a lot of work, so thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I've tried to be aware of doing it on an ongoing basis, and we've all learned from, not just we all, but the principals as well. And so when it comes to the end of the cycle, it's not so onerous because you've been doing it all along. You're aware of what people are going to, not necessarily will have seen. Oh, and the last point is, and I've asked you this in previous years, but if you have any evidence that I haven't seen, that maybe you've heard from people, community, just even conversations that you've heard, that's also allowable. It doesn't have to just be my evidence to you. It can be information that you've gathered or heard that you can add to my evaluation. Hopefully it's all positive. But you can add any of it anyway. So I think we're all getting much better at this.
Great.
Okay.
Anything else? No?
Good.
All right. On to the tech budget.
Just a note to myself. Provide background. Okay. So this is not for a vote. This is an update in your school committee, in your Google shared folder. is a copy of the actual budget proposal for Tech. But as a member, the Tech collaborative members have all been asked to provide this update to their school committees. They're not asking for you to vote on it. They just want me to show evidence that I've had it on an agenda and that you've been provided with the information. The actual proposal is in your Google Drive, but they wanted you to see the proposed budget vote document. And it supports the priorities of our member districts that are reflected in their strategic plan. And they've just, since they've been in the new location, their program is just growing by leaps and bounds. And they've just done an outstanding job, continue to do an outstanding job of really celebrating their students and everything that they're accomplishing. Whenever you go to one of those meetings, you leave feeling just so warm and just happy, and they're also positive. It's just a great organization and a great group of people, and we're delighted to be part of it. I didn't know if there were any comments or questions that I could follow up with them on either their proposal or their budget, but they wanted me to include it as an FYI and let them know that I've done so.
I wanted to comment. I'm glad about this, the Chromebook initiative. I think that is, you know, commensurate with the experience of the kids, certainly in this home district, but I suspect in most other Tech community districts, which I think is wonderful. I had the opportunity to get a tour of it the last time I was there with the students actually, like, there and in class. And it really is remarkable, and they're making so, the opportunity for everybody to be in one place has created so many vertical opportunities that they didn't have before that are just tremendous. And you see all the administrators in there reading stories and baking cookies. I mean, they just, it's, the atmosphere is just wonderful, collaborative, supportive, energizing, everything. So I hope that we'll be able to send more of our students there, because I really, if they can't be in their home district, it really feels like home.
It does feel like home. Our biggest challenge is the distance.
Yep.
But we feel that can be overcome just because of just how great the program is. And you're right, you know, you saw it through your lens. What we're finding is that when parents visit and they see and they feel the warmth and the support and the love of the kids, it's really a wonderful thing. They also have a playground project.
Yes.
That they've done a wonderful fundraising on. I don't know. They're I think going to break ground in the spring.
I think they are.
Yeah.
So. I think when I was there, what's that movie about Feelings Up? Is that it?
Yeah. Or so Inside Out, you mean?
Inside Out. It was Inside Out Day, so everybody was a feeling, and they were all colors. It was just great. It was just really awesome.
So that's it for the update.
Great. Well, we are moving on to new business, and we have the middle school club stipends.
And it's very straightforward, which is why I didn't ask Mr. Keller to be here tonight. It's really just, and I know we do this often, it's based on the fact that students lose interest in certain clubs, and then there's gained interest in another, and we ask that we pilot by changing the stipend for this particular one, to be applied to computer programming club to replace video club advisor. And then Kim keeps track of all of this because we tend to do it for a year at a time to see how interest is maintained. And then when we do a new agreement, we make the permanent changes. So I'm looking for your approval on that, this one.
Okay, and so for consideration, we have a request and recommendation of the superintendent to approve the request to reallocate $500 in stipend monies as outlined in the agenda material.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman and seconded by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. It's unanimous and so carries. And now we can move on to the school bus contract recommendation, which I know was supposed to be Mr. Dumas, but I assume, Dr. McLeod, that you're going to handle for him in his absence.
I'm going to do my best. And he apologizes for not being able to be here at family emergency at the last moment. So the the bus contract went out to bid, and we received one bid from Connolly. What was interesting and somewhat surprising when we received the bid was how much more it was going to be. The increase on the new bid was significant, as you can see in the spreadsheet. The hope had been, if there had been a new bid and it had been a two-year contract, that it would be aligned with going out to bid for, hopefully, the new, when we open the new school with hopefully a bus parking lot, that can affect the RFP. So we were looking for that. But when we got this bid, the recommendation that Mr. Dumas is making is that we exercise our option to maintain the existing option for one of two remaining years, at which point Mr. Dumas would do the same process again next year. He wanted me to point out the additional cost of gas in the existing option is actually mitigated because there is an agreement. There is a 5% escalator or de-escalator clause on the base. So that $4.17 was set at a time when gas prices were significantly higher. We do, although, have a clause that if it continues in this way, we will not be charged the $4.17. And so that will be an additional savings. So as you can see in the consideration, we are, I guess I leave that for Lori to read.
So there's a recommended motion, which is, well, in the consideration is request and recommendation of the school committee to reject the new bid and then exercise one of our two option years with Michael J. Connolly and Sons for providing school bus transportation services for the 2016-2017 school year under the existing contract. Does anyone have any questions about the motion?
I have a comment slash question, which is that you have updated us on a couple of occasions about the committee that's meeting related to start times. So I actually think it's an advantage not to enter into a new longer-term contract right now while those people are doing their work. And I guess my question is, do you anticipate that that will be a decision will be made in time to include that in the RFP next
yes.
year for the 1 year? And then and it probably makes most sense to make any changes when the elementary school building opens anyway.
It does.
But I just want to make sure we're...
That committee has been charged with making recommendation in time for next
Great.
Year's budget
Perfect.
Discussion. So we want a recommendation from that committee by next December at
All
the
right.
latest.
Well, then I think this is actually probably the best scenario regardless.
Okay. Yeah, given all those variables, including the potential parking lot that could yep. change the bid significantly, yep.
mm-hmm.
I think yep. this makes sense.
Any other comments, Kelly?
I just find it odd that they would come back with something so much more expensive when they
Isn't
know that we
odd?
Have 2 1-year options.
Yeah.
I don't know why they would think we would go for this, but so.
Guess okay. you don't get it if you don't ask,
I guess,
right?
I guess
negotiation monopoly.
We wouldn't look.
Can't say it.
All right.
So I would seek a motion to approve the recommendation of the superintendent that the school committee reject the new bid and then exercise one of our two option years with Michael J. Connolly and Sons, Inc. for providing school bus transportation services for the 2016-2017 school year under the existing contract.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman, second by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
It's unanimous and so carries. All right, we are moving on to the expense transfers. Dr. McLeod?
Yes. So I'd like to review the expense transfers. The first four, I'd like to point out, have already been approved in the FY16 budget. I'd like to go through each of them, however, because this is something we've all agreed to do around transfer. The first is expense transfer from the budget to be charged to parking fees. We had agreed that we would charge these lines to parking fees in the FY16 budget as an offset, and Ralph points out in his memo that this avoids munis allocation issues. So they've been charged to the budget throughout the year, and the transfer then takes care of the allocation in a single action. So do you want to vote on each request separately or all of them at once?
Well, the way the motion's written in the agenda materials is to vote them all together. Okay. But if there anyone on the committee has a preference either way, okay, I think we can vote them all
Thank
together.
Thank you. The next is to, from the budget, charge the revolving account, the F1 visa, which is exactly what they were here to talk about. So these high school teachers that are funded through F1 visa. And so that's a pretty straightforward transfer. Request number three is charging private tuitions and collaborative tuitions to Circuit Breaker. Expense number four is crediting the budget, so charging the budget from the budget, the data application manager salary. This is something that was approved in the FY16 budget to be able to apply that portion of the data application manager salary to IDEA stipends because of part of the work that that individual does for the district. So we are able to apply $5,000 of the salary to that individual. And then the final one is an interesting, and this is for this year, and it could change, it will change next year actually. Mr. Hay, who teaches both at the high school and at the Hopkins School, his salary is split between the two lines. And similarly, Mike Donahue, who this year is working as SPED chair for both the middle school and the high school, similarly, his salary is split between the high school SPED and the middle school SPED. So this would allow the transferring the portion of the two staff members who work in multiple locations. And again, it comes down to munis allocation and glitches that we run into when we try doing anything other than everything's charged to the same line. It has been charged to the high school throughout the year, and he wants to be able to allocate it in a single action. So that these are all of the requests that are being requested by Mr. Dumas, and I recommend that they be approved for payment by the school committee.
Any questions?
So we bought as a town the Munis system 2 years ago. So
town bought the Munis system.
So it says we as a town. The
Thank
town
you.
Bought the Munis system. And assuming I would think that it was a relatively technologically advanced accounting and expense system.
Why are you going there?
Is there, do we have any hope that this doesn't need to happen in the future? Because
so,
this seems ridiculously inefficient.
Yeah, this is a great question for me to follow up with Mr. Dumas on. I know that we're not yet there because we were so overwhelmed with the payroll portion of Munis that that's all we could manage. And we're now on top of it, and it's running very smoothly.
Okay.
At the time, that was not anything that we could even begin to take on because of the what it was going to require us to do as we were simultaneously working through the budget process. So whether or not there's any plans to, in this year's process, navigate into, I know that there's been training. I will definitely follow up and report back to the school committee.
Because from our perspective, this is not that hard, right? But from, I know you know this well, but I think this for the staff has to go through to execute this when there are, this should be able to happen in the system, I would think.
You would think. Yep. Okay.
That's all I have.
I will get back to you.
Thank you.
And I hope that Mr. Dumas is watching and that I did an okay job on his behalf.
Well, so I will seek a motion to approve the expense transfers as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman, second by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And it is unanimous and so carries.
Thank you.
And we now will move on to the last of new business, which is capital project article warrant number 16-052 in the amount of $7,577.25.
I have nothing to add to the consideration.
So the consideration is a request and recommendation of the superintendent for payment of invoices for capital project invoices as appropriated in Article 24. Does anyone have any questions on the item that was in our agenda materials? No? Then I will seek a motion to approve the payment of warrant number 16-052 in the amount of $7,577.25 to the vendors as outlined in the warrant.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman, second by Ms. Knight.
Quite a system going.
All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. Now we will move on to old business, which there is none this evening. And we have arrived at our second opportunity for public comment. Still nobody in the audience who would like to speak this evening. And moving on to items by consensus.
The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve the operating budget and other funds warrant number 16-051 in the amount of $283,955.62. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $295 from the Tri-Valley Spiritware fundraiser to be placed in the center school gift account as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $384 from the HPTA Spiritware fundraiser to be placed in the Elmwood school gift account as indicated in the agenda materials. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $500 from the Sky's the Limit fundraiser to be placed in the middle school gift account as indicated in the agenda materials.
So moved. Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman, seconded by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. Our next meeting is Thursday, April 28th at 7 p.m. right here in the middle school library. And then we will be attending town meeting. Hopefully.
It just snowed.
I know, right?
Wow.
And then we have two meetings scheduled in May on the 12th and the 26th. And I just want to point out that our May 26th meeting will be in the HCAM studios as opposed to the middle school, as there's a conflict for use of this room. And otherwise,
we'll also be reorganizing that meeting.
Oh, that's right.
Oh, boy.
And at this point, I would seek a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Bertrand, seconded by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And we are adjourned at 8:43.
Nickerson, look at that.